Yeah, you can do that. You can do that. Sure. Morning. So glad to be with you guys. We do have a celebrity in our midst. Joey, would you stand up? Yeah, now stand up. Wave. I don't want to know you. This is one of our young adults. He's the star of this independent short film you'll be watching over the next little bit. The Academy's giving it some nods. So, either way. Hey, let's get this series started, right? And join me, if you would, in some prayer. And then we'll jump in. Heavenly Father, we're honored to be in your presence this morning. God, we're so thankful for the way that you bless us and the freedoms you've given us. We know those don't come freely always in a country. And God, we thank you for men and women who've answered the call. And we honor that today. But God, we over this next little moment, God, we just ask that you would come and do what only you can do. God, I thank you for the mystery, which is Christ in us, the hope of glory. God, that the God of all things takes up residence inside of us and can change everything. So God, I just pray that you would stir it within me. God, stir it within my brothers and sisters in this place, and have your way. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. I want you to do me a favor. I'm sorry if you're blinded, by the way. This is not flattering for me, the spotlight up here. But do me a favor. Turn to your neighbor. All right? Turn to your neighbor. Find the one you like. And say, I'm not a spectator. I'm a participator. Find a neighbor that you didn't like as much and say, don't be a spectator. Be a participator. All right? Hey, the temptation is, especially over this next series, and really anytime you come to church, the temptation is to come in and sit back, hear some good word, you know, maybe catch a theory or two about Christianity, maybe not, right? If you're feeling really charismatic, throw out a preach, or get a pastor or something. I've never heard that, by the way. I probably would stumble and like lose complete control if somebody did that, but feel free, we'll try it out together. But what my prayer has been, over these next several weeks that we're together, my prayer has been that this won't be a theory to us. That this info would really move from our heads to our hearts. It would do something. It would transform inside of us. Because this is the truth. And you can say amen to this, that giant killing is not going to happen in the next 30 minutes. Right? I've learned more and more that the real amens, they don't come in this time. Right? The real amens come on Monday morning when you wake up and your kids are screaming, right? When the bill comes in, right? When your marriage is on the rocks, right? When you have other things happening. The real amen, where you stand on the word of God, where you say yes to what you hear in this moment, it doesn't happen right now. And so what I want us to see, what I want us to rest in over these next several weeks is the fact that theory is going to do us no good if we're just going to walk out and get whooped, right? And there's a lot of good Christians, saved Christians, forgiven Christians, who are going to be in heaven, who are getting whooped every day, right? The giants are just beating them up, right? We have giants in our home, right? There's giants in our marriages. There's giants in our finances, right? You know this. You see giants, big, nasty, big old-headed, smelly giants, right, at your jobs. Right? These aren't people at your jobs, right? But your relationships, all these different types of things, right? I mean, we recognize these things that stand against us, that look us in the face, that seem big, that seem to block out the sun. Right? We have those things, right? But I want to tell you that the truth is, if you are in Christ, we are born again giant killers, right? You are victorious. You are spirit-filled. We are overcomers through the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony. Is that right? Right? Participate with me. Right? No matter how much we feel defeated or down, Scripture says that we will not be crushed. Right? We are not destroyed. Those storms come around us, right? That we will persevere. Right? And what I'm sensing, I see this in my own life too, is that I seem to have an identity crisis between my Christian theories about a lot of things and then reality and what that seems to look like. Right? So my prayer is that we realize there will be this shift, because our Jesus was a giant killer, right? Jehovah is a giant killer. And so what it's time for the people of Christ To have that stirred up within us, to have our faith rise up, to stand up and say, look the giants in the face and say, hey, no more. We're taking back what the giants have stole from us. Right? And we're going to walk in that. So here, this is what I believe. I believe that for the people of God in this hour, that giant killing is not just possible, but it's an assignment. Right? It's an assignment from heaven for the people in this room to leave here and to be an example to the world that the giants can fall, right? So for the next 4 weeks, this is my encouragement. I want you to invite your friends. We're going to have fun together. I want you to invite your friends. I want you to come back. I want you to lean into this, right? And we're going to begin to declare God's word, God's truth, and really declare that giants must fall in our lives. Y'all good with that? Cool. All right, today we're going to look at one of the best-known Bible stories. If the title didn't give it away, you'll know very quickly, but we're going to look at one of the best-known Bible stories of all time. Go ahead and open your Bibles or your flippy phones, whatever you need. 1 Samuel 17. 1 Samuel 17. Now, bear with me because we're going to be in a series, and so you're not going to get all of it today. Amen, because we'd be here long. So, but we're going to ease into this a little bit. We're going to work around, so you will get the story. But don't go home mad today if you don't hear the ending. Okay, it'll be okay. I'll let you do some homework and you can read up. But let's read 1 Samuel 17. I'm going to start in chapter 12, and I'm going to read fast for the sake of time. Follow with me. Now David was the son of an Ephrathite named Jesse, who was from Bethlehem in Judah. Jesse had 8 sons, and in Saul's time he was very old. Jesse's 3 oldest sons had followed Saul to war. The firstborn was Eliab, the second Abinadab, and the third Shammah. David was the youngest. The 3 oldest followed Saul, but David went back and forth from Saul to tending his father's sheep in Bethlehem. For 40 days the Philistine came forward every morning and evening and took his stand. Now Jesse said to his son David, take this ephah of roasted grain and these 10 loaves of bread for your brothers and hurry to their camp. Take along with them 10 cheeses to the commander of the unit. See how your brothers are and bring back some assurances from them. They are with Saul and all the men of Israel in the valley of Elah fighting against the Philistines. Early in the morning, David left the flock in the care of the shepherd, loaded up and set out as Jesse had directed. He reached the camp as the army was going out to its battle position, shouting the war cry. Today we're going to begin our series, Profile the Giant Killer, by talking about something very important. Y'all can help me with it. We're going to talk about the power of... Say it with me. Submitting to authority. Yeah! So glad you're here today, right? Now, when I was little, I had my fair share of brush-ups with authority. For some reason, myself and authority, we didn't really seem to be on the same page very often. I went to a private school until 10th grade, and I went to a private school in an era where you could get whoopings. How many of y'all, just by show of hands, went to school in a day where they could whoop you? Yeah, look around. Hey, look. Yeah, not like that. Look around. All right, you don't have it bad, okay? You do not have it bad. Oh, man, my goodness. No, so, and I don't really know what one does as a kindergartner to deserve a whooping, but you can ask my mom, the truth is, every day the first week of kindergarten, I got a whooping. Monday I got a whooping, Tuesday I got a whooping, Wednesday I got a whooping, right? Every day the first week of first grade, I got a whooping at school, right? And that doesn't even tell you what happens when you get home. Alright? But I got a whooping every single day. I think I actually got my last spanking at school. My mom may have to correct me, but I think I actually got my last spanking at school in the 6th grade. And so it's kind of interesting. So I've had several brush-ups with that, and I don't know, like if you have armpit hair and peach fuzz, I don't know if the spankings really work anymore. I don't know, that's not my parenting advice, but I don't know how that works. But a lot of you know. A lot of you are aware that during that time, during the early stages of my life, my mom had the privilege of raising and disciplining me on her own. All right, she married Lloyd when I was 7, and you want to put the fear of God into somebody, have your mom marry a truck driver with a mullet, and that would change the world. That would change the world. But I love you, boy. I love you so much. But even still, my mom did a lot of the disciplining, right? And when you're getting beatings every day, I mean, every day you're getting beatings, my mom would have like broken blood vessels in her hand, different things like this. And so it didn't take long before she realized she needed some heavy artillery, right? The average things weren't going to work. And so she actually had manufactured, and I brought it with me. This is the original. This thing was handcrafted for my hind parts. This thing right here. Well, look at this. If you notice closely, if you look in there, there are holes. There are about six holes in here. And I just bear with me. You hear that? That's crazy, right? And so we named it because it got, notice how smooth it is. Notice how worn. It is called Spanky Wanky. How old you are to be naming things Spanky Wanky, but I was getting the beat down. I was my mom loving me. She was so good. I loved her. But it is funny because she actually saved this for my kids. She just passed it down. And what's weird, when I start talking, like when she starts talking about grandkids and stuff, and she hands me this, she has like this very kind of like crazed and like disturbed look in her eye, like revenge is about to come full circle. It's an interesting thing. So really, I just tell you that because I'm relatively young, but I wanted you to see my credentials on this topic, right? That I know a little bit about, talking about submitting to authority. But honestly, I've learned this, and young ones, this is going to go to everybody, but if this is a principle, a biblical principle, that if we could get a hold of, it'll change your life. It will absolutely change your life. And time again, it just proves that if you refuse to get under this principle, it will jack your life up, right? It will just absolutely ruin your life. And so what I want you to hear today is the message is actually not just like this half of the room. Because a little secret is it's harder to submit to authority the older you get. Right? It's harder. But I want you to think about this. Go with me. Alright? Everything that God has created has to submit to something if it wants to grow, if it wants to prosper, if it wants to thrive, right? The earth has to submit to the galaxy. It has to submit to the gravitational pull, right? The earth can't just, if we're gonna breathe and live, the earth can't just go off doing its own thing, right? Fish has to submit to the water, right? If Dory wants to find her mom, they have to stay in the water. If a fish jumps out and thinks, you know what, no, I'm gonna do something else today, it's over, right? A seed, in order for a tree to grow or a plant, a seed has to submit to the ground, right? The reason that trees can produce fruit and grow is because the seed is not constantly jumping up and trying to leave the dirt, right? We even as humans, we are born completely dependent, completely defenseless into an order, into authority, right? And so it's something that we have to learn to get under. And yet, especially in America, maybe more so than anywhere else, in this democracy and all this, we live in a very self-absorbed, self-centered culture where everything is I, me, right? It's my rights, my freedom, right? It's my wishes, my desires, right? But the truth is, there's actually no such thing as freedom without authority, right? That's a big part of what's wrong with our nation today. Is everybody thinks that they can go on doing their own thing, making their own choices, regardless of the repercussions of everybody else. But it doesn't work that way. Liberty actually has to have boundaries, right? If everybody just decided to do whatever they wanted, right, that's when fear and chaos and anarchy breaks out, right? So in order for freedom, in order for something to thrive and live and grow, right, there has to be authority, right? Ultimate freedom can only be realized in proper relation to authority. And that's why, when you look at the Bible from beginning to end, that's why the Bible is all about authority issues, right? Is because God actually is not trying to limit anything. He wants your ultimate freedom, okay? God wants you to prosper. God wants you to grow. Everything that you see in His Word, His authority is His love for you so you can become everything that He wants you to become. All right, and what the Bible is very clear of, as early as chapter 3 in Genesis, is what happens when you step out of the authority. Right? Whether it's the devil in heaven, whether it's Adam in the garden, whatever it is, it's when they stepped out of the authority of God, the curse came. Right? That's when death came. That's when freedom was stripped. Right? They were free in the garden. They were naked. They were unashamed. They could do whatever they wanted. And as soon as they stepped outside of the authority, they thought, no, my authority is going to be a little bit better. As soon as they stepped out, that's when the curse came. Right? It has limited us. Right? And that's why I think this is so cool. When Jesus came, Jesus didn't come offering a religion. I don't know if you know this. This might be brand new news to you. But Jesus doesn't really care about religion. Okay? Jesus came in the middle of a religion. Okay? But he came out of a religion. Right? And he came to establish a what? Does anybody know? Starts with a K. A kingdom. A kingdom. Now let me ask you this. What do you think if you are a citizen of a kingdom? And I think that's why we don't get it very much, because we don't really relate to that. But what do you think, if you are a citizen of a kingdom, what do you think your most important act would be? Submitting to authority. Right? And so that's the beauty of this story right here in David. It's almost so subtle. It's almost something that you don't really catch. But what put David in the position to be a giant killer was that David was a man submitted to authority. Right? In chapter 17, which we just kind of jumped in the middle of, this is what is happening. David is a shepherd boy. Okay, he's a shepherd boy who also serves in the king's court playing the harp. And right now he's kind of a gopher. Right? On the weekdays, he's out there with the sheep. He smells, he stinks, he's guarding the sheep. On the weekends, he runs into the palace, and King Saul has been tormented by an evil spirit. Right? He's at war, right? This is not his best week. And what he's found is that David, when he plays the harp, this beautiful musician, he gives him some peace. And so David is running back and forth from the pastures to the palace. He's running back and forth, and he's just kind of a gopher in between. Which doesn't seem bad, except for if you realize this, that's chapter 17. Do you know what happened in chapter 16? You know what just happened? David was anointed by God's prophet as king of Israel. David, this Aaron boy, had just been anointed king, God's chosen king. Now, let's think about this. Think about if you're in the middle of your 9-to-5, you're just on the grind, right? You're doing your normal thing, you're in the middle, but then because of this crazy election and no one really likes anybody, and you know, we're all kind of confused on what we're going to do, we're all going to migrate, nobody knows, right? But say something crazy happens and there's a write-in, right? There's a write-in in the ballot, and all of a sudden you get a knock on your door, Secret Service is there, and like, hey, somehow you just got voted president to be president of the United States, right? And like pretty quickly, right, after you realize that like there's no Ashton Kutcher, you're not being pumped, there's no hidden cameras, once you realize that like you're president, right, I would get pretty hyped. I'd be like, I need Air Force One here, like immediately. I want my Secret Service. I'm gonna start flexing on some people. I got some people I need to go talk to, right? I'm the most powerful man in the world. Right? It'd be amazing. That would shift everything in your life. But see, what a lot of people don't realize is that it took well over a decade from the point that David got anointed king till the time that he actually got to step in to that thing, step into that promise. Right? So, and not only that, David had to go back to his 9-to-5. Not only was he anointed king, but he had to go back to his 9-to-5. Not only that, he had to go serve the very man he was going to replace. Right? He had to go serve that. So what's the thing about that? David was, when we encounter him in chapter 17, he is en route, he is on the way, he is destined to be president of a nation. But right now, at the request of his father, he is a cheese pizza delivery boy. Okay? That's what's happening. He is going to be king. And at the request of his father, he's delivering pizza pies to the army. All right? Can you imagine that? Think about how easy it would be to be frustrated. Right? Think about how easy it would be to be impatient or to grow bitter. You know what's even crazier is this. that before it's all said and done, before David is king, Saul, the king, is chasing David down, has a bounty on his head, is going throughout the whole kingdom trying to kill David because he recognizes that the anointing is no longer on him, it's on David. And so David is out, he's running around, he's freaking out, he has some men behind him, but he hides in this cave, and he's in this cave, and then they're hiding out together, and the king comes in while looking for David to relieve himself, right? And he's probably whistling and just in there kind of relieving himself, and all David's men see this, hey, David, that's Saul, that's the dude trying to kill you, he's over there like kind of indisposed, if you know what I mean. And they say, this is your time, man. This is your chance. God has hand delivered this guy to you. There's no better time. Right? I want you to think about this. We overlook this. David had multiple opportunities to seize it, to take what was rightfully his. But this is what it says in 1 Samuel 24. Scripture says this. He said to his men, "The Lord forbid that I should do such a thing to my master, the Lord's anointed, that I would even lay a hand on him, for he is the anointed of the Lord." And with these words, David sharply rebuked his men and did not allow any of them to attack Saul. And so Saul left the cave and went on his way. Can you imagine that? Right? On the run for his life. But I want you to hear this, that David understood this, that authority, even if it's not good authority, it's still his responsibility to honor that. I'll say that again. Authority, even if it's not good authority, it was still his responsibility to wait and trust in God's timing. And he realized this. Paul says it like this. A lot of y'all probably heard this verse. But in Romans 13, it says this, "Let everyone be subject to the governing authority. For there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, whoever rebels from authority is actually rebelling against authority God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves." Man, there's so much to be said for this, because this is hard. I mean, this is an honest, hard thing. This isn't something easy. But for a lot of us, you know, we think we don't have authority issues, right? We're good with authority. It's all good. I don't have authority issues until we disagree with authority, right? Until maybe the authority is wrong. Until maybe the authority we feel is inadequate. Until maybe it's abusing its situation. But this is the truth about submitting to authority, that it's not okay just to submit, just to honor mommy and daddy when it doesn't interfere with your plans. Right? It's not okay just to honor mommy and daddy when everything lines up. Right? But, you know, there's some people that go into work, right? 2 weeks on the job, it's nothing but complaining. Right? They go into the job and as soon as the boss isn't around, they're cutting him down. They're talking bad about him, right? It's, oh, good for nothing. He don't even know how he got that job. He's no good. I mean, if somebody put me there, I can handle it, right? And it's just nothing but cutting and subversive and going, now sure they like the paycheck, right? We want the paycheck, right? But there's this disrespect. There's something in there. I want to tell you, that's not God's heart for me, right? I feel blessed to be a part of this place and this related family to me, and I feel blessed that we don't really have this here. But there are people that go to church who come in and they're so critical, and all they do is try to undermine the leadership and try to get in and just create this division and weave their way in, right? But there's a truth, there's a principle here that God is calling us to get under authority, right? And so I think it's so beautiful that knowing all that David knew, he knew he was going to be king. He knew he was going to rule over his father. He knew Saul, the man that he's with every week, that his time is short, and yet he remained submissive to those that God placed over him, right? Because he knew that in due season, God would raise him up. I want you to hear this. God will not use an unsubmitted person. Because if you're unsubmitted, you're in rebellion. Alright? God will not use an unsubmitted man or woman. Because if you are unsubmitted, you're in rebellion. Right? Power without a legitimate authority is illegal. Right? We recognize that. Government, we recognize that all over the place. Power that doesn't have a legal authority to it, it's illegal. And so what I want you to hear today is that God ordained this season, even though it was weird, even though it was strifeful. David wasn't loving. David was anointing king, and from there on, it was pain in a lot of ways. But God had ordained this season of his life. God had even ordained that authority in his life so that the authority could do a work to transform him from the inside out. Right? David, God had to prove David privately before he could raise him up publicly. Right? He had to see if he could trust David with pizza before he could trust David with the people. Does that make sense? It's progressive. Right? So while we talk about this, I know a lot of you, and it was even me as I was writing this and looking at this, God had been dealing with me. I have a lot of buts in my head. You know what I'm saying? I have a lot of situational things going on in my mind. It's like, well, is this always true? Is this sometimes true? Whatever. I want to tell you quickly from the story what submitting to authority is not. And then we'll get into what it is, okay? But very quickly, I'm going to run through this. Submitting to authority does not make you a subject to tyranny, okay? When I talk about submitting to authority, that does not mean that you become a doormat, okay? That does not mean that that God wants you to suffer abuse or be forced to be miserable, right? This is what happens. David, he shows up on the scene with the pizza pies, and he's sitting there, and everyone's afraid, and they're trembling, but they're talking about what the king will do for the man who beats Goliath, right? There's rumors going all around. Hey, man, Saul will give him his daughter to be wife, and he won't have to pay any taxes, and they'll raise him up, and they'll make him a warrior, and all these amazing things. And David hears that, and he's like, do what? He gets excited. He comes over, and he's listening to the men. And I want you to see what happens here, and watch how David responds. Verse 28, it says, when Eliab, which is David's oldest brother, heard him speaking with the men, he burned with anger at him. And he asked, why have you come down here? And with whom did you leave those few sheep in the wilderness? So he's putting him down, right? I know how conceited you are and how wicked your heart is. You came down only to watch the battle. Watch how David responds. Man, what have I done? Can I even speak? He then turned away to someone else and brought up the same matter, and the men answered him as before. All right? I want to share that with you because though David was a shepherd, he was not a sheepish man. Right? It was recognized even before this that David is a warrior, that David was stout, that David was, he was strong. Right? And so God is not asking for us to be punching bags. Right? But he is asking for us to be knights. He's asking for us to be soldiers. Right? Even in the New Testament, the centurion comes to Jesus and says, hey, I'm a man of authority, and with people in authority over me and people under authority, I know and I recognize that. And that's what God is calling us to do, to be humbly submitted. Right? The other thing that submitting to authority is not, that does not make you a yes man. Okay? Submitting to authority does not just mean you have to kind of bury your head and say yes and just go about and probably going to be a janitor and always be a janitor and never, right? That's not his idea, right? When David goes in and he meets with Saul, and he looks at Saul and he says, man, hey, I'm going to go take care of your giant problem. Here you have a giant problem. I'm going to go handle that, right? What does Saul try to do? He tries to get him all dressed up, right? He tries to get out his armor, his fancy armor. He tries to dress him up and outfit him in a way that David, he just knew that wasn't right. Right, David puts it on and he fills it out. He's like, man, this isn't the covering I need. This isn't the protection I need, right? I have something different going. So he knew in his heart what was right, and he stood firm. He looked the king in the eye and said, hey, man, I can't do it your way. Right? So what I want you to hear is that David did not step out of authority by standing up and by being bold and by laying into what he believed in. Do you hear me? Right? He was still under authority. He still honored authority. But the truth is it's a hard issue. Right? It's a hard issue for us. Right? So it's not being subject to tyranny. It's not making you a yes man. God does not want you to be just a low man on a totem pole forever, just being stepped on. You're not a ladder or a punching bag, right, for people, right? We can stand in and be bold people for God. Right? So what is, and then we're getting to the meat, we're almost there, guys. What is authority? What is authority good for? What are its benefits? I'm going to ask Chase. I'll ask Chase to come help me be my van of light today. Did you grab the prop on the front? All right. You go ahead and open that puppy up. This is the truth about authority, is that, and Pastor, I think, has used this illustration before, but authority is a covering, okay? Authority, it's an umbrella. Chad, you tested before. You gotta. Gotta be aggressive with it. You gotta be aggressive with it. Yeah, hey, this is the truth here. Come on, you should come over here and hang out with me. Alright? You gotta get it up, yeah. Kinda get her up there. Alright, there we go. Thanks. I want you to hear this, that the people that God has placed in your life, your parents, your bosses, even the government, right? Mentors, all these different people that God has placed in your life, they are a covering for you. Right? They are a tent. They are a shield. They are protection for you. Okay? The most important covering that we have in our life is the Word of God. Right? It is the ultimate authority for the believer. Right? It's a light. It's a lamp. It's an umbrella. Right? And what I want you to hear is that the Bible is our authority over and above everything. Okay? It don't matter what the culture says love says. It matters what the Bible says love says. Right? It doesn't matter what the culture identifies as something. Our covering, our umbrella, our authority is the Word of God. Right? It doesn't matter if you have Supreme Court justices dressed up in a robe hammering a gavel. Right? We don't listen to the times. Right? We're on a rock that is solid, that does not shift, and we stand under the authority of God. And that's something that God wants us to live and to stand in. Right? No matter what culture says. Right? But this is the truth. This is the truth. If the people God has placed in our life, especially the authority of God's word in our life, we are either under the authority or we're not. Okay? You see that? We're either submitted to what God says, to what God is trying to do in our life, or we're not. Okay? And a lot of us, we're trying to do like the, is it sunny? Oh, it's sunny. You know, we're out here. We're no, it's starting to rain. Homie Jesus, right? We're getting in here tight. Right? And that's not how it works, right? But God has called us, man, if we would get under the authority that God has for us, there's amazing things. There's life under here. There's freedom under here. Right? There's protection under here. Everything good that God has for us is connected to the authority that he's established, because it's for our good. It's for our freedom, right? It's so that we'll be placed in the right position when the giants come. All right? So this is what it is. I got four for you. The umbrella of authority is a place of, one, protection. Okay? It's so funny. I mean, I had to laugh. I think he's not here, so I'll pick up if he's not here. But the other day, it was like a month ago. It was like a monsoon outside. And we were supposed to come into church. And I look over, and Frank Sarah, he is walking with an umbrella, except for it's closed. It's completely closed, and they're running inside in the rain. This is no lie. He has a closed umbrella, holding it above his head, running inside. And I'm like, Frank, I don't think it works that way. I'm not sure, but I don't think it works that way, right? But this is the truth about our lives, man. Sometimes we're out here and we're like getting pelted with hailstones, and it's raining and it's cold and it's bitter and it's frigid and there are giants all around, and we're like, God, what's happening? What's up with all these storms? Protect me. Guard me. Right? And I want you to hear this, please. There are so many giants that you were never even meant to deal with if you were just staying under. Right? There are so many giants out there that we are battling. We're spending all of our time out here battling things, and God's like, you know, we're like, oh, God sent it. No, God was like, I did not send that. That wasn't me, homie. You're out here necking in the rain. I don't know what you're doing. Right? And there's so many giants that we face that we're spinning our wheels, right? And I found this verse this week. I've been reading through Proverbs, and I thought this was so poignant for the time. I hope you can see it there, but it's Proverbs 19, and it says this: a person's own folly leads to their ruin, yet their heart is against the Lord. Right? A person's own folly, I think it was up there actually, it's just real small on my life. A person's own folly leads to their ruin, yet their heart rages against the Lord. And this is what I want to say. There's too many of us, even in the kingdom, okay? There's too many of us, even in Christ, even going to heaven, that are trying to be rogue agents. Right? We're out here trying to Jason Bourne this thing. Right? And the truth is, man, this life is not about us picking and choosing what we like and what we don't like. Okay? It's not about us looking at the Word and saying, man, I really like this section over here, but that section, it kind of messes with me, right? right? It's like, oh man, like, God, you want me to tithe? Like, that's kind of personal, man. That's like my finances, homes. Like, I work hard for that, right? And yet we're out here and we're like in debt, and it just keeps raining and all this stuff is happening. We're like, God, I can't ever keep my head above water. And he's like, man, hey, get your finances under my authority, right? We got young people, and hey, I've been there, so I don't mind talking to y'all and hurt your feelings because I've been there. We got young people looking, it's like, I can't have sex with my girlfriend, right? What is that about, right? I can't look at this or look at that. And it's like, but God said, man, I have a blessing for you. I have something that you have no clue. I'm trying to guard your heart and your mind. I'm trying to protect you. I don't want you out here just getting ran over, just getting bullied, right? So many of us, we're supposed to be giant killers, and we feel like giant chew toys. You know, like they're just walking around and they're like, ah, you know, you see a dog with, you know, I have a German Shepherd, and he gets a hold of a toy, it don't matter how like unbreakable it is. 3 minutes and dude has like the squeaker out and it's like it's all over, right? And when you see something that's untrained and filthy and getting the whole, and it's like all over, right? And that's us, man. That's us. But God is so clear. It's so clear that He wants to love you. And He wants to protect you. We gotta get in line. We're either gonna submit, or we're gonna come up with our own standard and we're gonna get beat down. Right? This is the truth, man, so much as that destruction lies outside of God's authority. But in Psalm 91, I didn't put it up there for you, but it's all right, I'm just going to go with it. It says, it's a famous one. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High, he will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my strength, my God in whom I will trust. He will cover me with his feathers, and his wings will be my refuge. His faithfulness will be my shield and my rampart. And though thousands may fall at my left, though 10,000 may fall at my right, I will not be overcome. I skipped some verses, so that's why. If you're confused, that's okay. Go back and read it. I gave you the summary version. I appreciate you, Drew. You're doing good, man. Challenge to you is that, you know, the devil wants our families. You know, and our families and our homes, we need this so bad. Right? God has established an order. God has established a plan for us. Young ladies, I'm going to tell you, you need to find you an umbrella fellow. Right? You need to get you an umbrella fella, is what you need in your life, right? You need to stop settling for just any dude that comes your way, okay? And, oh, well, we love each other, and I'm lonely, and, oh, he snapped me, and it was great. Whatever that is, that's not a bad thing, by the way. But this is the deal, is that God, man, God has something for you. God wants to protect you. Right? God's trying to guard your heart, so you need a man that's going to submit. You need a man that's going to hold the umbrella. You need a man that's going to protect you, that wants to guard your heart. So men, you got to get under the authority, right? We're out here running around looking for women. We got no clue to do what to do with when we get them. It's the truth, right? You can amen me, right? It's the truth. So hey, there's a kingship that we're called to be under. Jaime told me this when he was here, and he said this before, but he says, God may be your father, but he's also your father-in-law. Right? God may be your father, but he's also your father-in-law, and you're crazy to think God's just going to give his daughter over to some bum. Right? It's not going to happen. Right? And so this is the idea, is that we got to get under the authority of the word. We got to get under the authority, the protecting, the covering that God has, so that we realize, man, hey, I need to protect my lady's heart. This is something I'm called to steward, right? Marriage. Marriage is this. Marriage is an umbrella. There is a God-ordained order. Don't get mad at me. It's in Scripture. But God has called the man to lay down. I don't know why you're the man, I'm the woman. God has called the man to hold that umbrella. For his wife, you look good. Your hair is better. But this is the truth, right? That the man is supposed to lay down his life for his wife, right? And the woman, in return, is supposed to submit to the husband, right? But this is what I want to say. Will you close that for me? This is what the devil wants to do. He wants to turn the umbrella. He wants to turn the authority that God has. I'm going to hurt some. Don't go away with it. Will you wrap it up? I got to use it in a different way. Satan wants to turn the authority. Don't go nowhere. I'm going to get you. God wants to turn, or Satan wants to turn the authority that God has, the order, the protection, Satan wants to turn it into a sword. Right? So instead of an umbrella, instead of a line in which God is trying to unify his church, unify his bride, unify marriage, unify families, bring them together, giving them one heart, one mind, one mission, Satan wants to come in and make it a sword. And start chopping and start attacking. And man, if my husband would just, and if my wife would, we're dividing and we're cutting it up, right? And I heard this the other day, and it's so good, but anything with two heads is a freak, right? And anything with no head is dead, right? I'm going to say it again, it felt good. Anything with two heads, right? A home with two heads, that's a freak, right? A home with no head is dead. And that's what the devil, thank you. Give Chase a round of applause. Hey, this is the truth. This is the truth, is that what God is trying to preserve and protect and elevate and lift up and make something beautiful out of, the devil is in there and he's trying to cut me, saying, man, I don't need this authority. Man, I'm not going to submit. I'm my own. I'm independent. I can do this. I can handle this, right? And we're lying to ourselves. Right? We're lying to ourselves. And this is the truth, is that David knew that his protection was not in Saul's armor. David's protection was not in some man-made, fancy, specialized thing that he was just going to come up with. His protection was being willingly obedient to God, right? Submitting to his authority and walking that out. So the umbrella of God is a place of protection. It's also a place of provision. It's also a place of provision. Look, there's something about being under the umbrella, that there is anointing, there is an inheritance, there is a blessing that God has for you, right? When living at home, I've had to do this off and on in my adult life, but there's something beautiful about living at home, right? Because when you live at home, everything that your parents have is yours, right? Everything that they work hard for, you get to partake in, right? The fridge, it's open sesame to you, right? The pantry, it's all good. The bills are paid, right? Their toys are better and bigger and louder and faster, and you get to hang out in that and enjoy that. And there's an inheritance. There's a pipeline of blessing by being under that authority, right? And we're called to leave and do that thing and start our own umbrella, our own little thing, and that's good. We've got to figure that out, right? But it's the same spiritually. Right? That Jesus, when Jesus came, this is God we're talking about. God put on skin. If anybody had the right to walk around and just submit and make it happen and just call people to bow, right? That wasn't him. Jesus came, and what did he do? He submitted. He submitted to the rabbis. He submitted to the leaders. He submitted for 30 years. And then when he said, okay, it's my time to go into ministry, he didn't just walk out freelance. He submitted to the legal authority of God. And he went down to the river, and he said, I need to be baptized. And not only that, I can't do it myself. There's an order that God has ordained. And so he goes up to John. And he says, John, you need to ordain. You need to baptize me. And what does John say? No, you're the Messiah. I can't baptize you. You baptize me. But what does Jesus say? He says, no. Even I have to submit to the authority of God. And so he goes into the river, and John baptizes him. And this is the beauty of what he did by submitting. His whole ministry was ministry of submission. Even in the garden, right, where he redeemed Adam's garden moment, where he said, God, what the Bible says is, they said, everything's possible. You've got to take it from me. I don't want it. Jesus expressed his will. You ever catch that? Jesus didn't hide his will. He expressed it. He says, you can do anything. Take the cup. But then he said, not my will. But yours be done. Right? And so Jesus goes down to the river. When he comes back up, what happens? The heaven opens. Right? The clouds part. Right? And God looks down and he speaks and he declares and he anoints and he sends the dove, a symbol of the Holy Spirit, to come down. And the dove came on his shoulder and the dove remained. And it was just a beautiful example that anointing is released. Blessing is released. When we remain, we get up under the authority of God. Right? Everything the Father had was then made available to him. Jesus lacked nothing. And that is, you know that Jesus is the archetype? He is the epitome of what God wants for us. Jesus said, I don't do anything on my own. Everything I do, I hear from the Father. I'm completely submitted in every area. I'm walking around under the umbrella. And everything heaven had, Jesus said. Everything. Right? And this is our temptation, is that we're tempted to be prodigal sons. Right? We're tempted to be under the umbrella and say, man, hey, I think I can thrive. I think I can go. I think I can do my own thing over here and be successful and live and have everything that I want. So we try to leave the nest. We try to run out here and do our own thing, right? And we just get beat down. Right? Because we're not giant killers outside of the umbrella of God. And so there's wisdom, there's accountability, there's life under God's authority. Number three, we're also hanging with me. Number three, it's a place of protection, it's a place of provision, and it's a place of preparation. Okay? I have a lot of brothers and sisters over here who feel called to the ministry. And that's a beautiful thing. Some of you are called to be wives and husbands. Some of you are called to all sorts of things, right, that God has for us. And being under authority is a place of preparation, right? Think about this. David, because he was anointed, he could have ran off and done whatever he wanted to do. But he remained submissive. He remained attentive. He said, man, God has the timing. It's God's will. God's going to make it happen. It's God's season. He's going to raise it up. And during that time, David was able to sharpen his skills. Right? During that time, going out to the pasture, he had little cans up and he was, you know, and he was getting it. And he was learning. He was getting faster. He was getting stronger. He was getting wiser. He was getting better. He was learning. Every skill was being sharpened. Right? And so much so that the lion, the bear, everything, he has little victory after little victory until all of a sudden he's out there and Goliath doesn't even seem so big. Right? All the army is literally shaking in their boots. They're terrified. They run when Goliath comes out and one little shepherd boy steps up and says, that's the dude? That's who we're scared of? Right? And notice this, he was perfectly prepared for the moment. Perfectly prepared for the moment. He stepped in. I want you to hear this. God watches how we respond to authority to see what kind of authority he can trust us with. Right, I said that earlier, but God watches to see the seasons and how we are under authority, how we respond to that. Are we going to cry or complain? Man, I'm bigger than this. I'm better than this. I'm not getting enough credit I deserve, or my ideas are better, or whatever it is. My parents are driving me bananas, whatever it is. But God watches the seasons that you're under that authority to see how you respond. And so we can't despise small beginnings. We can't despise these moments of authority, right? Because they're developing something in us, right? Last one, I'm going to ask the worship team if they'll go ahead and come up. It's a place of protection. Authority is a place of provision. It's a place of preparation. This last one is big. Because it doesn't really matter where you are in life, but it's a place of perfection. There's something about authority where God desires to sanctify and purify and refine with fire. There's a pressure under authority. Right? There's a pressure, there's an intensity. The heat is turned up, there's expectation. There's things, there's a molding, there's a pruning, right? And the truth is, because in order to submit, you have to be humble. What flies in the face of me, is laying down your pride and being humble, right? This is something I know in my life. Authority is something everybody wants, but nobody wants to submit to, right? I don't know why we want authority, because everybody under us doesn't want to submit. You know what I'm saying? Like, it doesn't make sense. But that seems to be the way of life, that we all want authority. We all desire influence. We all desire a platform with which God to use us or to speak into people's lives. We desire the authority to lead. And yet, we think it just happens. It doesn't just happen. No. You have to learn through submission. You have to learn through humility. You have to learn by being prepared, by being perfected, by being caught up in the fire. And as a man, especially, man, this is hard. Because we're proud. Right? We're proud. his submission to keep our hearts. Right? Kanye said this when he was here. He said, a lot of men want to change the world, but they don't want to change diapers. Right? But there's an order to this thing. There's a God-ordered authority that he wants. And I want you to hear this. Sustained success in your life, whether it's ministry, whether it's career, whether it's your marriage, whether it's your family, the only way you will have sustained success is by finding authority, the authority that God has placed over you, and submitting to it, getting in line, saying yes. Because God, what God wants to do is he wants all the body, all the members. We can't have one without the other. One can't go off. The foot can't run off over here and try to do something while I'm over here. Everything has to submit to one another for us to be healthy and grow. We have to submit to man. And then we're all being built up. We're growing up, unified up into the head, which is Christ. That's God's desire for his body, is for us to submit to one another and submit to him. We have to work on this, church. We have to figure this thing out. Because we're in rebellion. So this is what we're going to do. I'm going to ask everyone to go ahead and stand. And we have a little bit of time. We're just going to have one worship song right here. We're going to have one worship song. And then we're going to worship together. But this is what I want to do. We didn't have a prayer time really today. We had a very important time of prayer for the veterans. But I'm just going to ask, if there's anything in your life you want to pray for, whatever God has been working on, if you want to worship him, if you need to present your request to him, I'm just going to ask that we be patient. We have one worship song. But if you want to come, I'm going to ask you to go ahead and come. You can come now. And we're going to pray together as they lead us. But I know for some of us, God has been revealing that though we're saved, man, though we're redeemed, we're forgiven, we're going to heaven. I know for some of us, God has said, hey, man, you're not a submitted person. You're not a submitted employee. You're not a submitted spouse. You're not a submitted child. You're not a submitted son of the kingdom. Right? And so as we sing this song and you worship together, I know for so many of us, we want the protection. We want the blessing. We want the anointing. And for me, I know what I feel like I have to do is I gotta get more willpower. Right? I need more control. I need more influence. If God would just fix my stuff, I can kill the giants. I can slay the giants. I can move on. Maybe today it's a posture change. Maybe it's a posture change from pride and grit to submission and getting under the umbrella. Right? So I just feel like God was speaking. If you want your joy back, if you want your peace back, if giants have been taking the goodness, the fruits of the Spirit, the freedom that God calls us to, the Son sets free is free indeed, and we walk in here so many times with shackles all over us. What's wrong? Right? So let's just worship and allow God's authority and timing and provision to come. So Father, we thank you for this moment. God, we profess in faith that giants must fall in the name of Jesus, because we're not going to be rebellious people. Anarchist, we are part of a kingdom where you are king, you are Lord. What you say goes, and what's beautiful about it is it's not you trying to keep us under your thumb, but it's you protecting us and providing for us and preparing us and perfecting us under the umbrella of your love. So we worship you today. We thank you, God. We repent. We say we're sorry, God, when we've messed up. We ask that you would just take us and use us.